If you're a fan of the Creator's Game, this is the podcast for you. This is Off the Wing with Louis DeDonatis, all about the MCLA. Now, here's Louis.
On this week's episode of Off the Wing, I speak with Chris Marshall. Chris is the current host of Tilt and Flow on LSN. Chris is a former player for Chapman, as well as a former Game of the Week commentator for TLN, SLC Game of the Week. He's a guy who knows the MCLA inside and out, has been doing this for years. I asked Chris about this year's landscape and what he thinks about his former alma mater, Chapman University, and their chances to win it all. Also, be sure to tweet me at Louis25 using the hashtag AskLouis for anything about lacrosse and especially the MCLA. I am joined now by Chris Marshall. Chris is now the host of Tilt and Flow on LAC Sports Network. Chris played at Chapman and was a longtime color commentator and play-by-play analyst for the Lacrosse Network and also the SLC Game of the Week last season. Chris, thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Pleasure to be on.
So tell me a little bit about your new gig. You're the on-camera host for a daily four-hour show devoted entirely to lacrosse called Tilt and Flow on LSN. What are some of the challenges that have come with it? I would imagine filling 20 hours a week speaking strictly about lacrosse could come with its challenges.
Well, it certainly does. That's one of the things. It's really exciting to be able to have the opportunity to do a show like this. And like you said, I mean, filling 20 hours a week is pretty challenging. And, you know, I'd like to say that it happens because I'm such an awesome broadcaster. But it really takes a village. And I mean, that's one of the things that I really enjoy about working at LSN is, you know, you get to be with a lot of like-minded people and people that are excited to be there, excited about lacrosse. And, you know, everyone's watching the games. Everyone's looking out for stuff. If I miss something, then, my producer, Daniel Baker, who's fantastic, we'll see it, or Josh Hawkins, who's the co-host, obviously. And it's really an exciting place to be. It's unlike anything we've seen in lacrosse before. Obviously, you've got, you know, Paul Carcaterra and Paul Rabel doing their show for XM, and there's a weekly show on CBS Sports for the MLL during the season, but lacrosse has never really had something like this before. And so, I feel lucky and honored to be able to be a part of that at the beginning, and it's exciting.
When LSN was officially announced, like any new company or idea or new invention or whatnot, LSN, they had their fair share of critics. A lot of people were saying that lacrosse was just not ready for full-time 24/7 coverage. For as long as LSN has been on the air now, you've been proving them wrong. How does it feel to quiet the naysayers and really be a pioneer of sorts for the game of lacrosse through media and really elevating to the same level as other sports in terms of coverage? Football has NFL Network, basketball has NBA TV, baseball has MLB Network. Lacrosse finally has something like that now, too. Speak to that a little bit, if you will.
Well, first off, thank you. I appreciate the...
It's true.
You're saying about me.
It's true. Totally true.
You look at the landscape right now, and it's something that I feel like was absolutely necessary. I mean, we're seeing a lot of different streams and stuff for games. And, you know, I mean, I feel like that there needed to be a central place where you can go and get all of the things that you need. And this is an opportunity to give that to the lacrosse fan. And I feel like anytime there's something new, you know, it's hard for a community to grab a hold of it and look at it like, oh, this is the next thing. This is the answer. And I think as people start to see the level of the broadcast quality and the stuff that we're doing and the people that we're bringing in, people will become, you know, more and more on board. And you say naysayers and stuff. I think it's just people that haven't had the opportunity to see the kind of product we're putting out. And the perspective that I like to look at it is, you've got something out there that is the solution, you know, as far as I'm concerned, rather than a problem. And if you were able to have all of the games be in one place and be able to see all of the things that are going on, get the analysis, get all of the extra things that go along with having those in one place, I think that would help grow the game, because then you'd know automatically. You'd be like, this is where I should go. And I think that's certainly something that LSN can provide. And, you know, I'm excited to see the growth over the next few months and years as this continues to grow. But I'm just excited for people to have the opportunity to watch the product that we put out. And just looking forward to what people think about it, and you know, any kind of feedback that we can have to make our show and the broadcasts even better.
LSN is based in Boston. I think when that was announced, a lot of people on the West Coast and MCLA fans in particular probably assumed it was going to be all about NCAA lacrosse and professional lacrosse, and that the MCLA would receive little to zero coverage. That has not been the case. Dean Farrell of Grand Canyon has been on your show. Derek Pedrick, head coach of U of A, has been a guest of yours. So the MCLA has had a bigger presence than many would have originally thought. You're a former MCLA player yourself, and you're really the face of the MCLA from a media standpoint for a very long time. How important was it to you to bring the MCLA with you, so to say, and really give it a bit of a presence on LSN?
Well, that's something that was obviously really important to me. I mean, I love the MCLA. I played in it. I've been a part of it for years, and it was an important thing for me to bring into the fold. But I think that's one of the misconceptions, you know, about LSN and kind of the direction that we were going in. And it's like, oh, it's going to be, you know, just NCAA or just right. MLL or right. just Boston schools. And that's absolutely, that couldn't be further from the truth. And I feel like the lacrosse community as a whole is a pretty big community, as long as everyone is included. And that's sort of the direction that I like about it, is you're looking at it like you've got all of these fans who like the MCLA and all of these fans who like Division III, II, I, men's and women's lacrosse, and, you know, high school and professional. And together, the whole community of lacrosse is a big and strong force. And I love all lacrosse, so it's like I want to make sure that we're covering everything. And that's why it's important to me to be able to bring in the MCLA and bring in the women's game and make sure that we're talking about, you know, all the things that are important to everyone in the lacrosse community, not just a small part of it.
Right. Speaking of the MCLA and taking a look at one team in particular now, your alma mater and team and school that you take a lot of pride in, Chapman. They are number one in the country, almost a unanimous number one. In a year that many have called wide open in the MCLA, the further this season progresses and goes on, it would appear as if Chapman is slowly making this their year. I know this wouldn't be the first time you would have picked Chapman to win it all. Far from it. So, Chris, tell me, why is this the year Chapman wins it all?
I mean, like you said, the parity in the MCLA right now is as good as it's been maybe ever. We're seeing teams going out there and beating other teams, and you're not seeing one of those two teams that are going out and really showing that they are the definitive number one team. Chapman's going out and winning all the games, and I think the biggest win for them this season has been the BYU game. And not just that they beat BYU, BYU has had Chapman's number the last couple of seasons. I mean, that's no mystery. But Chapman was down in that game and then came back and won. That's something that BYU had been doing to Chapman for years. And I think there's kids that remember that. Obviously, Coach Hartley remembers it. I remember it, you know. And so there's this kind of opportunity for Chapman to kind of get the monkey off their back with that win. And I think that's a huge, huge win for them. Obviously, beating Colorado is another big win. You got to beat them to get to the championship. And the other wins we're seeing kind of back and forth across the country have been sort of mystifying. You know, it's like obviously Utah Valley taking down Grand Canyon, Santa Barbara this weekend going to Colorado and beating Colorado in Boulder. That's a huge win.
Right.
And That's the thing. It's like there's teams going out there that can beat other teams. I think Brian Cooper going down to Virginia Tech kind of dropped them out of the conversation, which is tough because I like him. He's a good kid. He's a great goalie at San Diego. I saw him play in high school. He's the heart and soul of that team. So that's a disappointing situation for them. But you look at these squads and it's wide open. And then you kind of coincides with this Chapman team being as deep as it's been in maybe since 2009. I mean, they got six guys on the offensive side that can hurt you. Their defense is good. Gradinger in the cage has been solid this year. I think this is Chapman's year. It's an opportunity for them to win it at home. And with as good as they are and kind of with the other programs kind of taking a step back, at least a couple of them, Arizona State included, then this is the year that it's got to be. If it's not this year, then I don't know that they get one.
Okay, Chris, I made a case for this last week on the show. I know you will certainly have a different outlook on this than I would. This is why I'm going to pose this question to you. Last week, I made the case that if Chapman goes undefeated throughout the regular season, which it certainly appears as if they will do, they got their big wins already. It looks like they will run the table from here on out. If they,
they got Oregon and Oregon tonight, and then Santa Barbara is looking like it's going to be a much more formidable task than we thought.
But they're certainly expected to win those games, I would say, and I'm sure you...
Exactly.
Right.
Yep.
If they go undefeated through the regular season, they win their conference tournament, heading into the national tournament, they will be undefeated. 2 years ago, we saw what many thought was one of the best MCLA teams of all time in Arizona State. They went undefeated all the way up until the national championship. I made the case that if we had not lost to BYU last year at Grand Canyon, we would have never won that national championship. I think that just worked wonders for us, and it was a blessing in disguise, that loss. I personally feel if Chapman goes undefeated through the regular season, wins the conference tournament, I think they have to lose one game in order to win the national championship. That's just the way I feel about it. Give me your thoughts on that.
Well, there's a couple different ways to look at that. The first one is, if Zach Handy's healthy, Arizona State wins the national championship. That's just about of bad luck. Zach Handy's first-team All-American face-off guy gets injured in the semifinal, can't go in the final. Arizona State still nearly comes away with the victory.
Well, to be fair as well, Cortland Jones did great as his replacement. He's not Zach Handy, I understand that, but he went 70% in that game.
Well, I mean, it's one goal. That's the possession. The final play came down to a violation on Jones. So you never know. But the thing about the MCLA is we've seen teams go undefeated in the past. Colorado State did it. Michigan State did it. I don't think necessarily it's as bad a thing. The thing I think that is going in Chapman's favor, if they're playing in the semifinal, I mean, you played in that state.
Right.
It's rowdy, especially with the night games. I mean, they sell out. And if they're in there for the semifinal and the championship, they're going to have that extra fan support. And all of these kids, they're veteran squads. You got Steve Kressel and Aperzezi and Gradinger. These are all kids that remember losing games that they should have won late in the season to finish their years. And here's the opportunity to make history. Exactly. I mean, I don't think we've ever had an MCLA championship win the championship in their home stadium.
I don't think so either.
I think there's a history element to this, and I don't disagree that it wouldn't hurt them to lose a game. I mean, they had a pretty close game against Stanford, but they're finding ways to win, and I mean, I think that's the important part about it. I don't see this team as a team that's got like a Connor Martin or a Marcus Wooden or, you know, one of those guys who, you know, is one of the all-time MCLA great players.
Sure.
They're a good team, and I think that's what makes them dangerous. It's any one of those guys in the starting lineup can hurt you. And they've got so many players on the sideline that they can go out. And it's like, I feel like the teams who lose those games are relying more on an individual effort. And so that's the kind of thing. I don't think it would hurt them any to lose, but I don't think that not losing is going to make them not win the national championship.
Fair enough, and that's kind of what I expected you to say. And I think, you know, it's two sides to every story. I think you have certainly a valid point. Looking at it from my perspective, the reason why I think they need to lose is just strictly because of what we went through last year at GCO. You mentioned in your answer the home field advantage that Chapman has, and, you know, it's a pretty rowdy atmosphere, like you said. I remember 2 years ago when it was announced that Orange County would be the home for the MCLA National Tournament. As a player at GCU, I was pretty upset because I knew Chapman was going to be in the tournament. And I just felt like if we had the tourney at GCU, that would give us a significant advantage come postseason time. However, Chapman is 0-2 in games at Chapman Stadium in national tournament games, so it hasn't been an advantage at all. How do you really explain that? Because, like I said, you call it an advantage. I think it's an advantage, but it hasn't worked to their benefit.
Well, I mean, the thing about it is you got to get to the semifinals. And, you know, if you're one of the last four teams standing, you're playing good teams. I mean, what it comes down to is they got beat by good teams. And that's the part about it. That it's like you can only have so much home field advantage. I mean, it's not gonna push your team to beat a team that's better than yours necessarily. And I think that having I can understand it from both sides of the perspective. You know, it's like obviously it's like, oh, well, these Chapman guys get to play this game at home. You know, it's a sleep in their beds. It's
exactly.
Like cheaper. You know, whatever. And it's like, I get that. But – there's also a certain amount of camaraderie and focus that comes along with travel. You know, it's like you're in a hotel, your focus is singular, you're doing this, and it's like, you know, if you're having to worry about going to class and taking finals and stuff during that week at school, you know, I mean, that's an added distraction. You know, it's maybe your girlfriend's there, or, you know, you never know.
That's true as well.
There's two sides to every story. So yeah, sure, it's great sleeping in your own bed and playing in your home stadium, but there's a lot of things that go into that as well. And I mean, just strictly outside of me being a guy who's a Chapman guy who played at Chapman, I think that the tournament itself being in Southern California has been incredibly successful. And you look at the venue at UCI and then at Chapman, I think it's about the right size. I mean, you weren't there, but seeing the games, you know, at the stadium in South Carolina or an old Cowboy Stadium, sure, it's cool. But when you pack like 1,000 people into a 30 to 50,000 person stadium, you know, it's not.
It looks a lot more empty than it really is, right?
Yeah, it doesn't have the same feel. Sure. And you know, obviously with the way that lacrosse is exploding in Southern California, you get, you know, high school kids and youth kids out there watching the games, and it's a lot closer for these teams that are, you know, your Arizona and your San Diegos and your Northern Californias and, you know, your Oregons and all the teams on the West Coast rather than I think South Carolina was a miss. I mean, I flat out think it was a miss. I think that was a bad choice. but it's interesting to see kind of what the next step is. You know, I don't know if they go to a regional championship and then just have a Final Four, or if they move something back into the Midwest or the South. Maybe you know, Dallas seems like an okay spot, but it's interesting to see kind of what the next steps are. I mean, obviously this is the spot where the tournament is going to be this year, and hasn't been announced what's going to be in for the following year. So I think that, you know, the NCAA's got to do a lot of thinking about what's the next step, what's best for these teams and these kids, and come up with something. I mean, I trust that they will. I mean, Ken's done a great job. Ken Lovick has done a great job, you know, driving the ship, and, you know, I have a lot of trust in the executive committee. So, I mean, I trust that they'll make a good decision and, you know, learn from past mistakes and be able to put something out there. But I'm excited to see kind of what the next step is, what they have in mind, and, you know, see where it goes.
Sure. And ultimately, it's a good problem to have because it signifies growth within the MCLA, and I think it's better for the league to have these types of problems. Last question before I get you out of here, Chris. What are the chances yourself and Trey and the rest of the gang come back down to OC this May to call, come back down to Orange County this May to call the national tourney?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's obviously something, you know, I've done for the last three seasons. I'd love to do it. So I'm hopeful that I'll be able to get away and get out there to call some games. I'm hopeful. I'll leave it at that. I'm hopeful. But I mean, I think you should be on the lookout for some extra MCLA coverage as the tournament gets closer on LSN as well. I know having, you know, Trey there as well as having me there, there's a lot of love for the MCLA. Margo, of course, there as well. And so I'm hoping that we can up the coverage and get a little tighter on these games. Certainly something that I talk about on Tilt and Flow, but as the tournament gets closer, hopefully we can put something together for the tournament, have a tournament show.
There we go. Well, I'm excited to hear that, as well as most MCLA fans, I'm sure. Chris, thank you for joining me today.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime, Luke.
Talk to you later.
And coming up next, it is time to answer your questions. This is this part of the week where you, the fan, dictate the conversation. It is time for our Ask Louie segment. Remember, you can tweet me at Louie25 using the hashtag AskLouie to get your questions answered live on the air. That's next. It is time now for Ask Louie. Remember, this is the segment where you, the fan, dictate the conversation. To get involved in the show, tweet me your questions to at Louie25 using the hashtag AskLouie. Each and every week, I will use your questions live on the air. First question, this is coming in from Mark Rolowicz, Twitter tag at MarkRoloLax4. His question for me is there any chance the SCLC is going to get two teams in this year? When he says two teams in, he's referring to the national tournament.
And Mark, that's a good question. There is a chance. Definitely is a chance. You look at the SCLC, the top team in it is obviously Georgia Tech. They're ranked number two in the polls. I would say Georgia Tech, no matter what happens from here on out, I think they are a lock to make the tourney. They're the only team other than Chapman to be receiving first place votes in the polls. They're number two, but it's not by that wide of a margin. They could be number one. They're in the tourney as far as I'm concerned. You keep going, you look, you see Virginia Tech at number 13. I don't have Virginia Tech getting in. Liberty at number 16. Right now, I don't have Liberty getting in. Florida State at number 17. They rose five spots in the latest polls. However, I don't have them getting in. And then you keep going. You see Georgia unranked. However, Georgia, we'll see about Georgia. Remember, Georgia, they're currently undefeated. They don't have any really impressive wins, to be honest, so maybe that, you know, explains something. But at the same time, they play Georgia Tech at the end of the season with an undefeated record. If they can run the table up to that Georgia Tech game, they can upset Georgia Tech. Now, all of a sudden, you're going to see a team that's going to rise in the polls, rise in the rankings, and could have a chance at maybe an at-large bid. However, to answer your question, is there any chance the SLC is going to get two teams in this year? I don't think so, and here's why. I don't think Georgia is going to beat Georgia Tech. I think Georgia is a good team, but I don't think they're good enough to beat the number two, who could be the number one team in the country. The only chance that the SCLC could potentially get two teams in this year is if Georgia Tech gets upset in the SCLC tournament, a different team wins their conference tournament, and then that other team gets the automatic qualifier, and Georgia Tech has to come away with the at-large. The teams that would have a chance at doing that, Virginia Tech has a chance. However, I've said this. I think I've mentioned this guy's name every single episode the whole entire year, and probably more than anybody else, Brian Cooper. Once again, with the loss of Brian Cooper, I don't have Virginia Tech as being real contenders at all, so I don't think that'll be Virginia Tech. Liberty, I think, has a chance. However, if you look back at the Liberty and Georgia Tech's meeting from earlier this year, Liberty went to Georgia Tech and they lost 15-7. Eight goals, is it an insurmountable number to make up for in their second meeting? I don't think so. Is Liberty a good team? Yeah. Could Liberty pull it off? Sure, they could, but Georgia Tech will certainly be the favorite once again. A team I look at and I think is very fascinating to me is Florida State University. They are a team that, on their best day, I feel like can play with almost anybody. They actually had a really good game with Liberty not too long ago on March 17th. They beat them 17-16 in a really tight game. I think Florida State's offense is explosive. They have the one loss on the season to the University of South Carolina, 15-13. I didn't see that game. I didn't hear too much about it. I'm not sure what happened there. That makes you question the team. But they have good wins. They beat Northeastern University. They crushed them, actually, 17-6. Like I said, the Liberty game beat them 17-16. They beat Texas State 15-4. Texas State, who was a team that was coming into this year, people were expecting them to do some good things. Haven't panned out quite like you would have thought they had. However, their only two losses are to SCLC teams in Liberty and Florida State University. So Florida State, in my mind, has probably the best chance of upsetting Georgia Tech. And keep in mind, Florida State, the remainder of their schedule, they play two very key games down the stretch here at the end of the regular season. They play Boston College Friday, April 8th, and they play Virginia Tech Sunday, April 10th. If they can get those two wins against Boston College and Virginia Tech, Boston College is a very good team. Boston College is a top 10 team. They're number 6 in the country right now. Virginia Tech is number 13. I actually think Florida State will beat Virginia Tech. If they can beat Boston College, then they have a real shot at doing something and maybe potentially getting the at-large bid. But as it stands right now, I think there is only one team from the SCLC that's going to the national tournament. That is Georgia Tech. I think there's the potential for two. I think the other team that has the best chance of getting in from the SCLC would be Florida State. I think in order to get an at-large, they absolutely have to run the table the rest of the way out. Sorry, their regular season table. If they don't win their conference tournament, they have to beat Boston College, number 16. They have to beat Virginia Tech, number 13. And I think if they don't beat both those teams, the only other way for them to get in is to beat Georgia Tech in the conference tournament and get the automatic bid, in which case Georgia Tech would then get the at-large, and the SCLC would indeed be sending two teams to the national tournament. That is this week's episode of Ask Louie. Remember, tweet me at Louie25 using the hashtag AskLouie in order to get your questions answered live on the air. And coming up next, I take a look at the latest polls that were just released by the MCLA. Stay tuned for that. And it is now time to take a look at this week's Under Armour MCLA Coaches Poll, the Week 6 Coaches Poll. Top 5 stayed exactly the same. However, there is a reason for that. The reason, here it is, and I let me explain this. I don't know when each individual coach or voter sends in their polls for the week. I'm not sure. However, based on the fact that Colorado, they did not move a single spot from number 4, and they lost to UCSB, and that game was on a Tuesday night, it would lead me to believe that these polls, they were already calculated before then, because there's no way the number 4 team in the country, Colorado, losing to UCSB, does not fall. So keep this in mind. Although we had the same exact top 5 for Week 6, we can be 100% assured that that will be changing for Week 7, because there's no way that CU loses to what is now the number 15 ranked UCSB Gauchos, and they don't fall from that number 4 spot. So granted, the top 5 stayed exactly the same this week. However, we can be assured that it will be changing next week. Number 1, Chapman. Number 2, Georgia Tech. They're the only teams that received first place votes. I would say deservedly so. Chapman has a huge game against Oregon tonight. Oregon's the number 10 team in the country. Oregon has an explosive offense. They're capable of beating anyone. Chapman has to go into Eugene to play that game. That is a game that Chapman very well could lose, and if they do, we will see shakeup there as well. Georgia Tech will rise to number 1. Where does Chapman fall? That's my question. Chapman beat BYU. Do they fall below BYU at number 3? You know, they won't fall below CU, because CU is going to have to fall after losing UCSB. So that's a question, man. Something to keep an eye on as well. We could very well have a new number 1 team in next week's polls. Continuing to look at the polls, you saw Boston College and U of A pretty much just flip-flop spots. That was a bit surprising to me, only because U of A, they lost to UNLV, who... UNLV, they rise and fall to the level of the competition. I told you guys many times this wouldn't. UNLV is a team that will upset you. They're also a team that will lose to teams they're not supposed to. So U of A only falling one spot, because that was a bit surprising to me, because UNLV had been outside the top 25 when they beat U of A. Boston College rising to number 6 is, I think they're deserving of that. And what will be interesting to me is to see, is Boston College a top 5 team next week? Is U of A a top 5 team next week? Who takes that fifth spot, because Colorado's falling out of the top 5. Then you look at GCU at number 8, and I will say something. You look at the points in the polls. U of A sitting at number 7, they have 491 votes. Points. GCU sitting at number 8, and they have 490. So the difference between 7 and 8 could not be much closer. GCU plays BYU tonight. If GCU beats BYU tonight, what do they do in next week's polls? That's another question of mine. Do they all of a sudden become a top 5 team? So, you know, this week's polls, not a lot of shakeup, especially in the top 5-0 shakeup. In the top 10, not much shakeup at all. But next week's polls could be huge in the way that teams move up, down, you know, whatever happens. We will see plenty of shakeup in the top 10. I can guarantee you that. And then this is something, looking further down the polls, this was something I had called for last episode. It was one of my bold predictions. I got the bold prediction right in terms of the team that was going to win. I didn't get it right in terms of what was going to happen in the poll. I had ASU falling out of the top 10 for the first time in years. And when I say years, I mean years. I'm not sure if they were ever outside of the top 10 in the Chris Malone era. They weren't outside of the top 10 in the Joe Thone era. Granted, it was only a year. ASU is officially outside of the top 10 for the first time in a long time. I'm not a historian. I don't know when the last time they were. Trey Lanthier, if you're listening, I think you might have an answer for that. That's a guy that knows ASU as a program better than probably anybody. ASU is outside of the top 10. Taking their spot was the University of Oregon. As I mentioned earlier, Oregon is a team that could rise even higher. They play the number 1 team in the country tonight. If Oregon beats number 1 Chapman, how far do they rise? Continuing to look down, you see UCSB sitting at number 15. They rose 3 spots, and that's not even factoring in the Colorado win. Colorado's loss was not factored in for them not falling from number 4. They stayed put at number 4, and UCSB at number 15, that's not even counting the Colorado win. You look at UCSB. They're a team that I've been singing their praises throughout the season now. I have been a big fan of their head coach, Mike Allen, for a long time. They're a school that they attract a lot of top recruits. They had a down season last season. Before last year, they were perennial contenders for the MCLA title. They've never indeed won one themselves, but they've always kind of been in the conversation. I think they are back to that spot now. Their win over Colorado was huge. 2 days later, they played Colorado State, and they lost 5-4. But to me, if I'm a voter, which I'm not, but if I was, I can't factor that in very much. And here's why. Arizona State, they're number 11. They were supposed to play Colorado and Colorado State this weekend. They were supposed to fly to Colorado. They were not able to make that flight because of the snowstorms in Colorado. Well, UCSB was able to get on their flight. They were able to make it there in time. But Colorado got absolutely crushed by a snowstorm. I'm not sure if any of you are friends with people in Colorado, follow people on Snapchat that are from Colorado. I am. I do follow people on Snapchat that are from Colorado. The amount of snow in that area, I've never seen anything like it. It was no surprise to me that ASU couldn't make the flight out there. But I just want to know, what were the conditions like in the UCSB-CSU game? Because I can tell you one thing, UCSB is not getting snow. It's pretty nice weather up there right now. So they were outside of their element for sure. They went through the gauntlet, so to say, one of the gauntlets of the MCLA, one of the toughest road trips. They played Colorado, Colorado State in Colorado. They got one of two, which almost any team in the country would consider a success. And who knows, if it's better conditions, maybe they go 2-2 and beat CSU as well, because CU is considered a better team than CSU. They beat CU. They lost to CSU. I think in next week's polls, they should continue to rise. Florida State, it's kind of an interesting team. They rose 5 spots up to number 17. Sonoma State fell a couple spots down to number 18. SDSU, they rose 3 up to number 20. SDSU is a team that I had called for their fall, so to say, and I think I've been right in that. Last year they had a good, successful season, their first successful season in years. You know, they made the tourney, they did some nice things, but at the very first episode of the show, I said that they would fall back down and they would become a team that was what they really had been for a long time, a team that was on the bubble of being a top 25 team. But they're certainly not a contender. They're not making the tourney this year. And SDSU, I'm not high on them anymore. Looking one spot below them, Boise State, they were at number 17 last week, fell to number 21 this week. And this was interesting to me. Throughout this season and going into the GCU game, they were a team that I think many had looked at them, and you looked at the games they lost. They had lost 3 games going into the GCU game against 3 great teams. They'd lost to BYU 14-11, so a close game. They lost to Colorado State 9-7. They lost to Colorado 12-11. So you looked at the scores of those games. They'd won every game outside of that. You said, hey, maybe they're knocking on the door. You know, maybe they're getting closer. Maybe they could be a pretty good team. Who knows? Anyways, they go into Arizona. They play GCU, and they get just the doors blown off them. GCU crushes them 19-5. That was a game I was at personally, and that was just a field day for GCU. By the end of that one, they had all their backups in. They just blew them out, a result that no one saw coming. I think Boise State is a team that is trending in the right direction. I think this year is over for them. But I think they did some good things. No one expected this out of Boise State coming into this season. So what I look for is how are they going to build off of this next season? Are they a team that's going to continue to get better? Or, you know, is this are they this year's SDSU, so to say, but not even as good as SDSU, because SDSU made the national tourney. I think they'll continue to get better. You look at the players they're bringing back. Liam Finn, Alex Wilson, Austin Lickley. Those are guys that has 36 points so far this season. Alex has 24. So two of their top players on offense, Austin Lickley, he's only a sophomore. Alex, a sophomore. Liam, a junior. They are losing Adam Smith, a senior attackman. This guy who had 28 goals, 15 assists, 43 points so far this season. That'll be a big loss there. But they're only losing one senior out of their top 6-7 scorers. So I think offensively they'll be fine. Then you look at their goalie play. They're losing a senior there as well. So how they are able to respond to those losses, they're losing Dustin Kelly in the net. How they are able to respond to the loss of those guys will tell me a lot about this team and this program, but I think they have the potential to be a pretty good team for a long time and start to really knock on the door. And then UNLV at number 23. This just makes me laugh. because they rose five spots. They were 28 in last week's poll, so they got back inside the top 25. But I have said many times on the show, UNLV is a team that will upset teams. They rise and fall to the level of their competition, and they got another team. They beat U of A 8-6. U of A is a team that I felt was as good as any, and a team that could beat any other team on any given day because of the play of goalie Tanner Canego and their head coach Derek Pedrick. But hey, UNLV got them. They beat them 8-6. U of A had to go to UNLV, and it doesn't surprise me. UNLV is, hey, they lost to Santa Clara earlier this year. Are they a better team than Santa Clara? Going off the U of A score, yeah, absolutely they are. Santa Clara beat them 12-16. In Nevada, they beat them 16-12. So, you know, it's just funny to me. I have to laugh. I can't help but laugh. And yeah, U of A, hey, I respect them. I think they're a good team. But being a former member of GCU, a team I certainly didn't like. So I like seeing UNLV take them out. That made me happy. And then you look at Utah Valley University falling all the way down to number 25, a team that is on the brink of being eliminated from the top 25. They are a team that I felt like heading into this year, I was at their first game of the season when they had the biggest upset victory in MCLA history, beating Grand Canyon University, the defending national champs in the first game of the season. They were a team that I felt like could be this year's Cinderella story. And I didn't know how good they could be because at the time they beat the number one team in the country in GCU. You know, I looked at that team, and they're from the RMLC, one of the toughest conferences in the country. At the time, I felt like being from the RMLC, they had probably paid their dues. But, however, since that point, they haven't been the same team that they were in that first game of the season. And so I think we can officially close the book on Utah Valley University and their Cinderella season. So long. See you next year, guys. And before I get you out of here, the last segment of the week, that's right, bold prediction. And it's not a bold prediction for the week. It's the bold predictions for tonight's mega games. That is coming up next. And it is now time for this week's bold predictions. And I really shouldn't even say this week's. I should say today's bold predictions. As I've told you, we have a couple great games. Maybe that's going too far. I was going to say individually the greatest day in terms of matchups in the MCLA so far this season. We have two games tonight between four top 10 teams. We have number one Chapman going to number 10 Oregon. We have number eight Grand Canyon University going to number three Brigham Young University. And the first game I'm going to take a look at is Chapman versus Oregon. I have number one Chapman beating number 10 Oregon. This is a game that is going to be, I think it's going to be a 1-2-3 goal game, probably a one goal game. I think the difference is that Chapman has to go to Eugene and play in Oregon. Oregon is not an easy place to play by any means. And then I look at these two teams, and I see strength versus strength, and it's almost like something's got to give. Is Chapman's defense going to win this game, or is Oregon's offense going to win this game? You look at Oregon's offense, and you look at three guys in particular. You look at Grant Clifford, John Finnegan, and Michael Marcotte, their attack line. Those guys are absolutely dynamic. They have the most points on that team by a wide margin. Their offense and their team seemingly runs through those three guys. If Chapman can find a way to neutralize those three, you're not going to stop them. You know, it's that old phrase, you can't stop them, you can only hope to contain them. Well, this applies in this situation. Because you're not going to stop that starting attack. You're not going to stop Clifford, Finnegan, and Marcotte. There's just no way. But if Chapman can contain them and they can win enough possessions at the faceoff X and their goalie can make a few saves that he probably shouldn't, I think Chapman can win this game. I look at Chapman, their defender, Nicky Mullen. I think he has to have a day, and I think their goalie, Gus Gradinger, has to play out of his mind in order to give his team a chance to win this one. This one is going to be close. But I have number one Chapman beating number 10 Oregon on the road. Here's why. Defense wins championships. Defense wins games. When it comes down to a defense versus an offense, more times than not, I'm going to take the defense, and I'm taking the defense in this one. Number one Chapman beats number 10 Oregon on the road. Second game now. Number 8 Grand Canyon University against number 3 BYU. This is going to be a great game. Almost everyone out there is picking BYU. BYU, no question about it, has been the better team up to this point so far this year. But I look at GCU, and they just crushed Utah. They crushed Boise State the game before that. I was at the Boise State game, and I saw a different GCU team than I had seen all season leading up to that game. Boise State was a team that, going into that GCU game, a lot of people said, you know, they had played close games throughout the year. They had played a close game with Colorado, a close game with Colorado State, and a close game with BYU. BYU only beat that team 14-11. Going into the GCU game, a lot of people were picking Boise State to beat GCU, actually. And GCU, well, I don't think there's any really nice way you could put this. GCU flat out embarrassed them. They beat them 19-5, absolutely crushed them. And there were a couple things that I saw from GCU in that game that I hadn't seen at any other point throughout the whole entire season. There was not the 10-minute stretch in that game. As Coach Guy mentioned on last week's episode, he said in every single game they have had a stretch where they just had not played very good lacrosse. They had just shut down. They didn't have that against Boise State. They played a full 60 minutes, and they put that team away. The other thing I looked at is Ronnie Hamway. He had not been himself going into that game throughout the season up to that game. Ronnie Hamway was the same Ronnie Hamway that was the two-time All-American the previous two seasons. He started to look like himself. They were able to win some faceoffs. The offense was able to get some touches. And when that offense, the most talented and still the most explosive offense in the whole MCLA, when they're able to get the ball, they will make you pay. They scored 19 goals against Boise State, and this is a team that is just now, I think, finally starting to come into their own and starting to play some good lacrosse. I think for all those reasons, I have GCU going into Utah and beating BYU tonight. I think it's going to be a close game, but I think GCU has the mental resolve, and I think they're finally starting to peak just so enough that they're able to get this win against BYU. Like I said, this weekend, just a couple incredible games. Who knows what's going to happen? Those are my two bold predictions. I have Chapman beating Oregon. I have GCU beating BYU. They're going to be two games I'm going to watch as much as I can of, and you should too. It's a great weekend in the MCLA. It's a great night in the MCLA. Pay attention to those games. Those are my bold predictions for this week. Book them. Have a great weekend, everybody. See you next week.